Welcome to Platts Commodity Pulse. I'm John Kingston, the Global Director of News, and I'm based in New York. In reviewing the explosion in U.S. gas supplies, there's one negatively impacted country that tends to get overlooked, Canada. The extensive physical pipeline ties from Canada's gas fields into the U.S. and its reliance on those markets long have been a strength of Canada's energy economy. Now those connections mean that the fall of U.S. natural gas prices have dragged Canadian prices right down with them. In this case, the border between the two nations is superfluous. In terms of gas, it's an economic union. And for Canadian gas producers, there are a lot of drawbacks to that right now. With me today to discuss some of the ramifications of that link and the fall in prices is Samantha Santa Maria, Managing Editor of Platts. She's based in Houston, joining me here in New York. Sam, how ugly has it gotten from the producer's side? We know we've got the Henry Hub as the most visible, transparent price of natural gas in the U.S. It has been below $2. Mm-hmm. More recently, it's kind of pushed up back toward $3 and crossed the $3 level. Has the movement been mirrored in Canada, or have there been places where it's been the fall's been even more severe?
The fall's been even more severe in Canada, especially the Western Canadian benchmark hub of AECO, which is out in Alberta. That has also fallen with the Henry Hub, which fell, you know, 190, that's a 13-year low. AECO fell to $1.40 Canadian per gigajoule.
Right.
That is a 13-year low as well.
Right now, Canadian dollar, U.S. dollar, roughly right. The same. So. Mm-hmm.
So that's been a tremendous impact on the producers, the shippers, the downstream players. And one of the main things to look at here is what that means for Canadian supplies and trying to get to their former traditional consumption markets. That's been a major, major issue.
Now, I understand there are a couple of places there that Platts has traditionally assessed the markets where the activity has dried up to so little that getting an assessment has even been tough.
Right. There's a border point on the eastern side, Niagara, New York, where obviously the gas transports from the eastern Canada side over to then New England and New York. That used to be a pretty liquid point back in the day when Northeast markets wanted Canadian gas. That market hasn't traded for months. Zero activity, zero deals, and if we get one, literally we get one.
Right. And now the company that's really most affected by this is TransCanada. It has a massive natural gas pipeline system that runs from Alberta, mm-hmm. also I guess some links into British Columbia, down into the U.S., through Chicago, and then up into Ontario, and up into the Northeast U.S. It has been hit by a dramatic drop in volume, a dramatic drop in revenue, and right now it's before Canada's National Energy Board in a pretty contentious toll-making process, which really kind of establishes the way it's going to go ahead in the future. So what's going on with TransCanada and the NEB?
Well, as you said, TransCanada started their rate hearings for 2012, which means their tariffs for this year haven't been decided upon. 2012 and 2013, that's going to continue till September. Now, TransCanada has a long, contentious history with their shippers. They've had their throughput fall from 6 BCF a day about 5 years ago. Now it's about 3.5, you know, nearly 50% drop. That's huge. So they're trying to figure out what is going to work. How will they regain their throughput? Well, the first thought was, let's raise rates, because if we can't regain the throughput, let's regain the revenue. Didn't work. Massive pushback from shippers. They went back to the drawing boards and said, okay, let's slash long-haul tolls to try and get Western Canadian suppliers to put their gas on the system and then incentivize people down the road back in Eastern Canada, back in Northeast U.S., to try and buy that gas. And that's the case that's right now before the NEB.
Right. And of course, the reason we're talking about the East so much is that these markets are being served increasingly by gas from the Marcellus. Mm-hmm. So the Marcellus, even though it's miles from the Canadian gas fields, has probably had its biggest impact on Alberta gas, more than really gas, let's say, down right. on the U.S. Gulf Coast.
Yeah, that's absolutely the case. And NEB and TransCanada and those rate hearings talk again and again and again about Marcellus gas pushing out Canadian supplies for Northeast markets. It's very, the argument here is, if I'm a Northeast buyer, why would I want to pay a toll for gas coming from Alberta when I can pay a short-haul tariff and cheaper gas? Because right now, Pennsylvania gas is the cheapest gas in entire North America. Why wouldn't I do that if it's right in my own backyard?
And of course, as the price of gas falls, if the toll goes up, the toll as a percentage of the total cost gets completely out of whack with historic norms.
Absolutely. So there's absolutely no incentive other than just pure supply diversification of your portfolio to reach out to for Western Canadian gas anymore.
Now, you talked about Niagara, and traditionally that would have been a site where Canada gas would have crossed into the U.S. What's happening now, or at least what's projected to happen, is that not only is Marcellus gas going to displace gas from Canada, but Marcellus gas is going to make its way up into Ontario and also presumably into the Canadian Maritimes, backing out Canadian gas from Canada.
Yes, that's what's going to happen within the next few months. There are several projects on the boards right now to move gas from the Marcellus into eastern Canada, specifically Ontario. And I think the numbers, when you look at them, out through the next 4 years, several pipelines, including TransCanada, are trying to move gas from Michigan or Pennsylvania or Ohio into eastern Canada, specifically Ontario, to the tune of about 2.7 BCF a day within the next 4 years.
So it almost sounds like TransCanada knows that its model can't be keep going on. So
it's almost if you can't beat them, join them.
Right. So they'll get as much money as they can. Right. But one of their long-term plans, then, they've got this steel in the ground, mm-hmm. thousands of miles of it. It's a valuable asset. One of this might be to turn it into an oil pipeline.
Yeah, that has been talked about by the market, kind of hush-hush for many years, and what to do with, like you said, this tremendous 8,000-odd-mile pipeline going from west to east. What was interesting in the last earnings call by the CEO of TransCanada, Russ Girling, he finally voiced that thought they had. Well, we have the steel in the ground. That's value to us. Why can't we transport crude oil?
And on the other end, of course, in the east, you don't have a supply of crude right. the way you have a supply of gas, but you do have East Coast refiners that are either now shut mm-hmm. or have shut and have been struggling because right. they couldn't get cheap oil. They're buying oil out of the North Sea or West Africa, paying higher world prices. So Canadian crude or even Bakken crude right. put in there would be a great boon to them.
Yeah. If you see that recent announcement by Carlyle about the new refinery, well, not new refinery, but the refinery they just bought, the two supplies he talked about was Marcellus gas and Bakken crude. Surely, you know, the Western Canadian producers, the oil producers, are thinking, well, why can't I supply that market as well? Again, I've got the steel in the ground. It's not a question of trucking or barging or railing.
Well, Bakken crude has gone to the East Coast,
yes.
of course, but it's going by rail,
right.
which can get pretty expensive.
Yes.
And in the same way that if the price of oil fell or continued to fall or whatever, that price of rail doesn't necessarily go down with
mm-hmm.
it. So that becomes a huge part of the total cost in the same
right.
way that with very cheap gas, that tariff becomes a very significant part. So that's oil. But Canada will still have this gas.
Yes.
And the East Coast market is, the Northeast market is lost to it, so they're looking west.
Right.
Or they're looking to the east, to Asia. So what are the LNG plans for Canada?
The LNG plans are about a few years away. There are 5 export projects out of British Columbia specifically. And what is interesting about this is, to put in a larger context, there are, in North America, 13 total LNG export prospects, 5 in British Columbia alone. Now, the first one that's going to come online, if it does, and it's got the export licenses from the NEB and the Canadian government, will be in about late 2014. It's a small little project by a company called LNG First Partners and then the Haisla Nation. That's really small. That's 250,000 a day, 2014. The real big one is Kitimat. That's the one that everybody's mm-hmm. watching. Late 2015, early 2016. Definite interest from Asia, some Asian equity stake in there. So that looks to be very, very promising to go forward and get actually built.
Now, is that the project where KOGAS is a partner?
That is not. Actually, KOGAS is in with Mitsubishi with the other project that's out there, which is Shell's. A lot of market participants think that is the third one that's most likely to cross the finish line for various reasons. Shell is a very distinguished operator, experienced operator, not just in Canada, but in LNG elsewhere around the world. And the companies that are involved, the Asian companies, they're not just equity stakes, they are utilities. KOGAS, biggest single buyer of LNG. So you know they're serious, they're vested, they want that gas, and they will pay to make sure that gas gets to them.
So you don't see all 5 projects going forward?
I've heard it talked that all 5 will, but you know the people who are talking and the people who are backing these proposals, it's unlikely. They're all clustering around British Columbia. They're all having to negotiate for rights. It doesn't seem like a likely scenario. What I have heard from the various sources out there is like 3. So we know that BC LNG and Kitimat had the export licenses, so that's a major advantage on their side. Now, of the 3 remaining, Shell, with the Asian investors, you've got Petronas, which was the Malaysian state-owned oil company with their partner Progress Energy, which interestingly enough they just bought.
Huh.
So they now got control of the upstream mm-hmm. and they've now got control of the prospective LNG terminal. And the third one out there is BG, another experienced operator globally. So really, if you could throw a stone and you hit any one of those, they all look very promising, but it's highly unlikely that all five will get export licenses.
One thing I think that's significant, of course, is a great deal of talk in the U.S. about exporting gas as LNG, and there's a lot of political opposition to it. You know, why should the U.S. be exporting its gas? Why don't we keep it here? Right. You don't have that in Canada. From all indications, the Canadian government, the regional governments, the provincial governments, as well as you mentioned one of the First Nations, one of the native tribes up there is in favor of this. So that is not a hindrance up there as it is in the U.S.
Not at all. The Canadian government is pretty much falling all over itself to make sure these projects get off the ground, which is a completely different story than in here in the U.S. I think the Canadian government has awoken to the fact that they've got a lot of supply and they need to find avenues that pay the producers to incentivize this continued production, job creation, and all that comes with it. There is not that much of a problem with or argument that you're taking away our supplies, which we could use right in our own backyards, mainly because Canada's power generation mix is very heavy on hydro, nuclear, and coal, in different orders depending on the provinces. Natural gas is also ran in fourth place.
And well, in the U.S., it recently was at 32, and it tied coal for the share
of
generation capacity.
That's right.
So you've not really seen a lot of coal displacement by natural gas as you have in the U.S. yet?
Not at all. Although, there's a reason why all these pipes are going to Ontario. Ontario as a province has a provincial mandate to shutter all that coal-fired generation by 2014. They're almost halfway there. So that's why a lot of gas pipes trying to push all that Marcellus gas into Ontario. Here's the problem. So I said earlier, 2.7 BCF worth of pipe. You look at on the demand side, if you shutter all that coal generation, you take gas on instead, you're only getting about 1 BCF a day of demand. Really, because Ontario's power generation mix, when it comes to gas, is less than 3%.
Because it gets a lot of hydro from Quebec.
Exactly.
Samantha, thank you very much. We'll be back in a few years, and we'll see how these LNG facilities all worked out. For Platts Commodity Pulse Video, I'm John Kingston. Thank you for joining us.